Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Peter Chimboa.
Thank you very much, Chair of Proceedings. I think they usually call them Master of Ceremonies, but we call them Chairperson of Proceedings. The Minister who has been here, and the Permanent Secretary, Madame Katie Lamolo, and also the Director of Education, and all commissioners. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to have one or two things to tell educationists. The educationists are the most knowledgeable people, so I'm very humbled to be here and to share one or two things. I've told you, my specialization is in the future, specializing in the futuristic way of life. I've heard the minister talk about drivers, and also our conference organizers talked about drivers, receptionists, and also sweepers and messengers, and so futurists are talking about how Uganda is going to look in the days ahead. Number one, they won't be the driver. They will be called transport resource executives. They will be asset owners. They are supposed to be in charge of the cost of running a vehicle and also trying to figure out how it can deliver greater value at lower cost. So that's the business of the ministry. The next one is what you call sweepers. They are not sweepers. That is a bit derogative. And the public service, I'm sure, must work around that. They are called environmental hygienists. That's what they are. They are not sweepers. They are supposed to watch the dust content in the air and also the visibility and profile. The next is what you call messengers. They are not messengers at all. They are supposed to be knowledgeable about the ministry and share this with others. They are called interactive executives. Those are what you call messengers. They are interacting with outsiders. They are interacting with those who are inside the organization. Now we have got what you call receptionists. Receptionists are called client and customer advisors. They advise, they inform. So you don't have to reach the Permanent Secretary's office when there is someone called client advisor at the front desk. They are not just receptionists. No, they are knowledge workers. They know everything about the ministry, and we respect them for that. There is no one called personal assistant. These people are called decision support executive. So if somebody is a personal assistant to the PS, no. The so-called personal assistant must read documents. And when the permanent secretary comes, he's supposed to work through the options and activities that the permanent secretary must prioritize. That is a knowledge worker. Must go through all the documents. The permanent secretary cannot go through all of them. But if you're a so-called personal assistant, it's like almost you lift the permanent secretary or the minister to walk around and so, and give her tea and make her drink it. That's an assistant. Then this one is a decision support executive. There are no accountants in organizations. These people are called financial solutions engineers. That's what they are called. They are supposed to work with limited budget and find solutions around that. That's what they are. They find financial solutions by engineering, working around a number of impossibilities and creating a new reality. That's what they are. Accountant means you sit down, deal with the budget as it is. There is no money, and that is all. That's not what is expected of you. You must make it work, irrespective of the circumstances. Ladies and gentlemen, my time is limited, and I want us to divide our conversation in three areas. The first one is who you are, your mindset. I have heard they've talked about retirement. There's no retirement. It's God who has authority to retire people. At 2 p.m., they put you in a box and they put you 6 feet under. That is called retirement. The rest of what we have in life is career transition. You move from one stage to another. My colleagues who are stepping out now are called transitions. They are going to become advisors to schools. It's only in Uganda where somebody leaves work at 55 or 60 and is forgotten. No, the ministry is still going through many other phases. They are advisors. They have a wealth of experience. They can support elsewhere. So when you talk to me about someone retiring, somebody dying, somebody dying, you can actually move from your current job, but it doesn't mean you are moving out of life. You still have to continue with life. So who you are should not be a deficit mentality. No, it must be a growth mentality, not a deficit mentality. So you stop being a participant in your own self-oppression. Right now, you are a number of you who are leaving the ministry, you are starting a totally new life, completely a new life, and you have to keep learning. So who are you? Who are you right now? You are a person who lives in the growth sector, not in the limited sector or fixed sector. Number two, we are going to look at how we operate, how we work. I think the permanent secretary mentioned some very important lesson around time management, which she picked some time back. That's wonderful, but how do you operate? How do you operate with people? The minister has talked about cliques. Cliques are for people who died a long time ago, but burial has delayed. That means you don't have what it takes to make your point. Then you have to rely on undermining people, backstabbing them, and telling truth here and there. No, that's a sign of death. You have died. Each one of us created in the image of God. We have something someone else wants, and we have to share. Now, if you can't share the goodness in you, that means you have died. You are just a moving corpse. You breathe and live, but you died. Burial would be announced at age 60 or 70, but effectively you are. Now, how do you operate? The last one is how do you grow? And I want to summarize this very quickly at career level, at financial level, at social level. Now, let's start with, first of all, who you are. I want you to be careful. What you have around is your attitude, the way you see things and the way you respond to them. The way you see. So you have a positive mind, but every day you wake up in the morning, the issue is, most of the people ask me, PK, how are you? I say, I am better than I deserve to be. Why? Maybe God has been kind to give me a new day. And I didn't, there are some guys who are in the mortuary this morning, they're there. I'm not there. So I'm privileged. There's nothing so special that I've done that we're not able to do. So your attitude, the next one is skills and knowledge. And I'm going to talk about this, the amount of time you need to spend reading and listening to information and ideas that feed your mind. So we need skills and knowledge. Ministry of Education is going to be run by artificial intelligence and data. I would like to know, beyond what you qualified in, what else do you have? At NSSF, when we interview people, we ask them three questions. We say, number one, what is your 1+2? Meaning, you got a degree in statistics. That's very good. Have you added on anything else? When the president of Uganda locked down Uganda, did you go online to study something? Because lockdown doesn't mean stand still. You're supposed to have done something. Yeah. When the president locked down this country in March 2020, there were 1.3 million online learners. By March 2021, there were 14 million online learners. Meaning what? The people are learning. We look at the future of the Ministry of Education. It's going to be digital. That's what it is. So give us two more digital courses you have done. 1+2. The next question we ask in NSSF is, what is your CSI? CSI means what? You are coming to NSSF. What are the challenges we people in NSSF don't see? Now, tell us what you think you are seeing in the Ministry of Education that I'm not seeing right now. Next, tell me how you are going to solve those challenges. Number three, tell us what impact it will have to our organization. That is an interview question. That's leading you to creatively imagine the future and your relevance. Now, we're going to be talking about how do you operate with the threes. Those of you who are Christians, I'm a Christian, we have got what we call the fact of three. In Christianity, there are three who are in one. There is God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Here I am talking about your attitude, skills and knowledge, and your character. The other three I've talked about is your relevance in the ministry is around how you are able to see challenges no one can see, and solutions and impact. Those are, again, three. Now, there is something more. Is your open-mindedness in terms of attitude. Be open-minded. Be vulnerable. I am standing here. But there is a lot I don't know, and I'm willing to learn. That's what it is. So we can be vulnerable. We are all incomplete leaders. There is something new for us to learn, as I'm going to share with you shortly. So, attitude, open-mindedness, a deep sense of curiosity, and willingness to experiment. Those are the three again. We have an open mind, we are curious to learn, and we are willing to experiment. Now, I would like to mention also, going back to Christianity and why the power of three is important. In Christianity, there are three major events that makes Christianity Christianity. The first one is the death of Jesus Christ. He died. Now, it's good, but he died. Number three, resurrection. He resurrected. I don't know of anyone who walked in this world and jumped up from his grave after just a few days. The last one is ascension. Those are three. We started with three. God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now we have got these three. Now we have got attitude, skills, knowledge, and character. Then we have got another three. Challenge, solution, and impact. I've told you that I think NSSF is probably the only first organization to emulate other organizations. Around the world, the best and most powerful companies are Facebook, there's Google, there's Microsoft, there's Alphabet, and there's Tesla. Those are the biggest, most powerful companies around the world. In the region, we have got Safaricom, we have got East African Breweries, we have got Equity Group and others. In Uganda, I think we are number one. Two, accept people to work in a senior management position without a degree. What are we looking for? Imagination. Your capacity to imagine the future. And that's all. If you can walk into Ministry of Education and point out that you people in the Ministry of Education, you don't see that, you don't see that, you don't see that, I will be taking notes. And then I will ask you the next question. How do we solve those things you are saying? And what will be the impact? I'm not very sure you need a degree to do that. You may, because a degree gives you tools of analysis, but you may not necessarily. So some of our best performing employees, that's how they are. In Tesla, some of the best performing people don't have. And so we are open-minded and willing to experiment. Now, let me go back to where we started. Who are you? Please have a growth mindset. Keep reading and learning every day. Number one is, again, a factor of three. Make sure you have three coaches around the world. Coaches don't have to be physical like the director here or the permanent secretary. No, you look at the internet. And you need to have at least three individuals you emulate, who mentor you without knowing you. People you are looking up to, and every week you spend 3 hours learning from them. Factor of three. Three mentors and 3 hours every week. And now, for those of you who are married, for those of you who have spouses, please remember, spare 3 hours at least a week discussing the one thing that keeps marriage working, that is money. Discuss how you are earning the money, how you are spending it, how you are saving it, how you are procuring debts, and how you are investing. Those are the 5 topics squeezed within 3 hours every week you must discuss. Let nobody cheat you about love, this, that, well, money is key and it's the most important thing. If somebody doesn't have money, as I mentioned to you earlier, he's already dead. A broke guy is a moving corpse. So you must be able to have money. That's what it is. Without stealing time and money from the ministry. When you steal from the ministry, you are stealing from yourself, and you are called a blessed fool. You are blessed to be in the ministry, but you don't even know what it means to be here. Now, who are you? Who you are is determined by how much you are going to do work around yourself. 3 hours every week. And I'm asking you also to make sure you invest in yourself and you have what you call a smartphone. the smartphone must have at least three learning platforms. Each one of you learning new things in areas which you did not specialize in from university. Like I've asked you, I've told you here, if they take me on to public service reform, I contribute. You are not going to be anything in the public service unless you can answer the first questions I raised. 1 + 2, 1 + 3. So you couldn't have been in Ministry of Education and you are still stuck with the statistics. And you do a degree in education, you do a degree in education, PhD in education. No. There has to be something more. There has to be something more. And that's what we want to see. And then use that to tell us the future. How are things going to be in the future? Don't fall on history. So if you want a job and you give me a CV that is 5 pages long, you are celebrating history. You will have written an article of which was peer-reviewed in 2014. That's history. That was before the COVID occurred. So that's history. That's a history book. I would like to see the future going forward. How will the Ministry of Education look when we have 5 robots working with us? What will the situation be like? Well, the Minister of Finance doesn't have money. Supposing our budget is chopped by 50%, how will we operate meaningfully to the citizens of Uganda? Give me some ideas. How can we operate at 50% budget and still make Minister of Education the best ministry? That's the way, that's the future. So you can't tell me, no, PK, don't ask me those questions. No, no, you don't know that I got a first class in statistics. You got that in 1965 or 1975. We are talking about different things now. So I do apologize. We're talking about taking the minister forward. And that's why I disagree with the performance appraisal. That there should be nothing called performance appraisal. Because performance appraisal means history. You are remembering things of January. That's not possible. I'm talking about today and the future. That's where I am. Now, but if you call me for performance appraisal, take this example to your family. In your family, you have got a wife called Jane. How can you call Jane in September and tell Jane, sit there, we are going to do performance appraisal? In January, you burnt food. In February, you didn't welcome visitors. For goodness sake, this is September. So, guys, who are you? You are a person who is independent minded and who is learning all the time. Now, I want to inform you before you go to how you operate. For those of you who are going to have learning platforms, I know lunch is getting ready and we should be moving, but I'll be quick. For those of you who have got learning platforms, and I'm requesting all senior members of the ministry to have, but I'm also appealing to my colleagues at the bottom of the pyramid. I know very many people in the fund who came in as transport resource executives. Right now, they are right towards the top. Why? They are able to articulate challenges we don't see. They are able to do that. That's why the fund is the way it is. Within 10 years, they move from 1.8 trillion to 18. All the banks in Uganda, the money they have is 17.5 trillion. NSSF has 18.4. How? They are people with imagination. Your ministry now has achieved something, 60%. You can achieve 80-90. But the people who can do that are there right now. They have the imagination, but it has to be tapped. Now, it can't be tapped through performance appraisal, looking at history. Let's have what we call an end of the month performance enhancement conversation. Performance enhancement conversation. Let us have that every end of the month, 2-3 days before the end of the month. I'm going to ask Madam Nachejwe Meron, if she's here, to share a one page which a supervisor will have with the people below. One page, only one page. And this one page says this. In this month of June, this is what I've liked about your performance. Me, the supervisor, this is what I like about your performance. But this is what I think you can improve. Don't say weakness. Weakness, you are threatening somebody. So I want to say, this is what you can improve. And the other thing is, you can try doing something differently. And this is the support I will give you as your supervisor. Have we agreed? Yes. Now, let's look at July. July, we expect 4 things to be done. Can we agree? Yes. Can you sign here? I sign here. Commissioner HR, get a copy. 1 page. I'm talking about what you are doing well technically. I'm also talking about what you are doing well in terms of behavior. I'm looking at both. But I'm not looking at them as a cop, a policeman. No. I'm looking at it as a coach, as an enabler. Enabling you to bring out the best in you. Why? This is the Ministry of Education, for goodness sake. Education means what? In Latin, it comes from the word educare. Bring out the best in someone. That's what it means. So you cannot bring out the best in somebody by saying, you didn't do that. You didn't do that. You didn't do that. That's command and control. It destroys the psychology and confidence of a person. So you can't tell a driver that you are a driver. You are just a driver. Why do you drive like that? He is a transport resource executive. He is taking full care of the asset he has been put before him. So in education, there is no command and control, but there is a conversation that brings out the best in you. And that is the conversation that must take place every month. We can't wait for end of the month, or sort of end of the year, to do what you call fondly appraisal. Appraisal is dead, gone, and buried. That's what it is. Now, if you want to keep it, there's no problem. Because the public service hasn't passed this. But I remember I've talked to the PS, and even the major, certain things have to change. Why? The world around us is changing so fast. We can't remain stagnant. The people who are working in the ministry and those who have worked there is a lot they can give. So what are those other organs we have to establish outside? And that is very legitimate and acceptable. So you don't have to go anywhere. When they ask you, who is your coach? Madam Indira Noy. And she's in the United States. She doesn't know you. You are staying here in Nalia. But she's your coach. Yeah, why? You follow every speech she makes when she's talking to schools, when she's talking to educators. You have been following her, what she writes and what she says. She's your coach. And you can write, my coaches are the following. You don't have to write, my coach is the director of education and so on. No! It can be someone around the world. Why? The world is now global and everything has been democratized and flattened. That's it. So how do you grow? You grow by reading and learning every day. And please make sure you have some mentors, you have some coaches. Make sure you have a bit of that. Let me go to the issue of money. How do you operate? On the day you get a job is the day you plan exit. On the day you get married is the day you plan divorce. Yeah, my niece got married recently and I mentioned to her that please, Margaret, today is the day you start planning divorce. We were at the reception and people said, who brought this man? It's totally crazy. No, I'm not. Margaret, I want to tell you that the guy you get married to, Philip, there are approximately 6 girls who are looking at him. Okay? Whether he knows it or he doesn't know, they are there. And just imagine they are there. And right now they are at this wedding. You make a little mistake, you'll be giving them room to come. So every single day, work as if you are going to be divorced tomorrow. In the ministry, work as if they are going to sack you tomorrow. So you won't have time for backstabbing and doing criticism and so. Why? You are defending your relevance for the future. That's what you are doing. So you don't have time. The same thing is, you give your marriage all the best you have. Because you are assuming and you are thinking, tomorrow is divorce. Tomorrow is divorce. Think of your children. Think of your children. At the time you transition, I want to call it career transition, not retirement. You need to be aware that you should have set up an alternative source of income. An alternative source of income, which is 80% of your current pay, monthly pay. 80%. 80%. And you should have set up this business without stealing time and money from the Ministry of Education. Otherwise, you're not going to learn. The other thing that you must pay attention to is that what you earn right now in the ministry, only 50% is yours. The other 50% goes elsewhere. 10% goes to tithe or zakah for the Muslims. 10% means what? This is money for God. You appreciate God keeping you alive, and you want God to extend the frontiers of his kingdom. Now, if you believe in witchcraft, the percentage is high. Prosper. So it's not 10%, but 10% is what God provided. The other 10% is what we call the family development fund. The other 10% is what we call college inflation. Most of your children, by the time you are leaving the ministry, they will be going to university. And they will require payments. And remember, you won't be able to work as hard. Why? Because from age 50, the body becomes a battleground for non-communicable diseases. When you reach age 50, your body becomes a battleground for diabetes, high blood pressure. You get the gout, cuts of pork and beer, which you have been taking, and many other things. So you need the 10%, which is tithe, 10% for development of the family, 10% college inflation, 10% for your circle or investment club. How many of you belong to circles, investment clubs? These are people looking at the future, seriously. And then you have got another 10%, which is emergency. Now, I want to look at the expenses. Expenses have to be controlled. Ministry of Education should deliver a cultural revolution. Because what we have today is cultural blackmail. Parents telling their children to have functions of so big with tents, 300 visitors for introduction ceremony. How? Where do you get the money from? Traditionally, I will talk about my clan because I'm a clan leader. We have agreed in my clan that no, when there's an introduction ceremony, there must not be more than 7 people coming. And when you are, you must come on a Saturday at 12:30. Remember, you come at 12:30, we are going to release you at 4. So when you arrive, we ask, I come from Central Uganda. You give us the certificate of the kingdom. Celebrating our heritage, you give it to us. Number two, we want a land title in your two names, Margaret and Philip. Because what you were dating about? You were dating, should have been talking about money and great investment, nothing else. So so you give us a title in your two names. The third thing, you give us the plan. What are you going to do with this title? How are you going to develop it? If it's a plan, show it to us. Show the plan. Who is constructing? When are you starting? When are you finishing? Why 8 bedrooms? Why this and so? You explain. The next thing is, you give us the number of your circle or investment club. We don't want our daughter to seductively embrace poverty. We want a person who belongs to a club, who belongs to a circle. The last one is a gift. Where I come from, majority of my relatives are Muslims. They are also Christians like myself. If I'm in charge of the function, the gift is a Bible. If it's a colleague of mine, well, one of my relatives, and there are many of them there who are Muslims, is in charge, you bring us a Quran. The function is over, we go for lunch. By 4 p.m., you must be gone. No alcohol. No. There are nothing like a gift which primitive people bring in the courtyard. Very primitive people. They bring bread, they bring fridges, it's a deep inferiority complex. Why? Because Uganda has been in scarcity. Before 1986, before Mr. Museveni came, there was so much scarcity, really. Too much. So now the parents who grew up in scarcity are trying to make up. No. We have to fight the issue of cultural blackmail. That is one way of saving money. The next one we have in our clan is the graduation party. When you come for graduation, like my relatives, when there's graduation, we come with a check. There's nothing like a party as such. We can have some bread and tea, but we come with a check. Some of my relatives are wealthy. They bring a check of 10,000. Some bring a check of 1,000, but we have agreed you have to come with a check. When you come with the check, it's the name of the graduate. We tell him, this is your money. $5,000. But you don't touch it. We are giving it to this fund manager. He is going to save this money and multiply it. You can access 20% of it when you are age 40. If you are married, the two of you have to be there to sign for 20% of that money. Number two, When you reach the time for marry, that is how our weddings, they don't have more than 50 people. Why? We invite about 500 people, but most people don't watch the dates. In our family, there are 6 days available. For the Muslims, it's Eid. On the eve of New Year's Day, or New Year's Day itself, that's wedding time. On the eve of Easter and Easter Monday, that's wedding time. Eve of Christmas and Boxing Day, that's Christmas. That's wedding, sorry. So, well, let's look at Boxing Day. We have invited 500 people. How many people will be awake at 10 a.m. to attend Christ the King function? Either they are out of town, going to Rukungiri, Soroti, and where? Others are drunk. They are still in hangover. So, in the church, we are 30. And we go to the reception, we are 30, 40 people. The costs have moved from 10 million to 3. At your wedding, we come with a check. Now, the check is about 10,000 or 20. You are not supposed to touch that money until both of you are 60. And you must be together. So if you have divorced, that kind of confusion you have, me, I don't like the woman, whatever, it's okay. You are not going to touch a coin. We are giving it to your children. That's intergenerational wealth. So that principle is a bit of discipline. That you get married at age 32, we give you $10,000. We know by age 60, it will be 1 million. 1 million. When you are graduating at age 23 and we give you $10,000, at age 60, it will be exactly $1 million. I'm not talking about shillings. That is about money management and our culture and what you call black tax. Don't give your relatives money. Stop it. Because if you are not in the Ministry of Education, where would they go? What will happen? Or if you are sacked tomorrow, what will happen? Can you please every week advise your relatives to find something to do and lead them to that? The dependence and all those things, please get rid of that culture. You are Minister of Education, this is very important. Take back to schools the volunteerism. If you don't show us the hours of volunteerism in NSSF, you get no job. We need to get some evidence that you have gone out of your way to volunteer and support society. And you have good manners, really. That's how it works. Now, let me go to something very interesting, which is more around investment. I was told there is a circle in the Ministry of Education?
Yes.
Okay. But is it possible for the ministry to save people from themselves? Don't make it voluntary. When you join Ministry of Education, let this deduction be automatic so that you don't feel it. But at the end of the day, you are going to feel different about it. It's just like the schools. Every school is complaining about, or rather parents are complaining about school fees, saying there's too much and so on. But there are different ways of engineering the issues of money in the schools. But let me start with the Ministry of Education. Ministry of Education, we need a circle. Anyone who is a member of Ministry of Education should belong to that circle. And please don't say, if I wish. Can you create it to be just that way? And people are going to feel good after 6 months when they see how much has been saved. Because when you don't put those restrictions, there is no way you will create a pot of gold for your family. Let that circle, the benefits, be transferable. That if you move from Ministry of Education and you go to Ministry of Water, whatever you have saved can be transferred. It's portable. It's portable. So when you are a member of the circle in Ministry of Education, don't say, my money is going to get lost. No, you can transfer it and move to... You can move it to the next ministry. Why do I talk about pot of gold? There is money that they give us after our service. And I will give you an example. Recently, someone came to my office, a professor in Mulago, and he says, I'm going to retire. I said, yeah, career transition. So I asked him, what do you have? He says, I've got a farm in Bushenyi. I've got also a house. I said, you have a house? Who stays there? He says, no one, but we go there during Christmas and so. Now, that's an investment of 600 million. He goes there once, twice a year. That's called idle asset. Aha. Then I said, what about the cows? He also has a farm in Impiji, and he has houses in Boyogerere. All those are scattered assets. They are very good for you to feel you have assets, but the assets are not building anything. So I asked the professor that, can you please liquidate all those assets? How much do you think we can get from there? He says $5 million. I said, can we get that $5 million and put it on a fund account? And every month, they will be giving you about 10 million shillings. Is that 10 million enough for you to survive and live on well with your wife? He says, yes. That is called liquidity number. That's the money you need to survive well with your spouse. Why? Because your children may not be interested in the farm you have in Wobles, in Kasamombe. You have got some rentals there. Your children are in IT, they are working in Coca-Cola, they are working in Dar es Salaam. Do you expect them to go there? You are an old man now, 60, and you are in traffic jam going to Ngokongjeru to look at your rentals. You are in traffic jam, you are sneezing, coughing, and so on, and whatever. And your children will not even follow up on that. So why don't you stay where you are, in Naguru, and have what you would call, we call that financial assets, rather than physical assets. You migrate from physical assets. Why? Our grandfathers liked physical assets. I own that house. I own this one. I have got a piggery. I've got cows here. I've got. It's enjoyable to say, but are you getting anything out of it? Secondly, will your children go for it? You may not. Right now, they may be very. They respect you. Every time you say, "I'm going to Mokonjeru now. I don't know about traffic jam, but I'm going." They say, "Okay, Dad, you go. We'll follow up." And so now, when you drop dead, the first thing they are going to do is to serve those things. So manage your pots of gold in the family, and also manage your mindset that you can move from physical assets to financial assets. You and your spouse, you have only 10, 20 years to go. Look at yourself and celebrate your life comfortably. Avoid the traffic jam running to Mpiji now to check on your trees. Which trees your relatives have stolen? Or some of them, they have even burnt. So you just make your life a little easier to live and enjoy. So I would like you to, and I'm willing to share the constitution and the governance documents for the Ministry of Education circle. If you haven't been part of it, you can start now. You need to appoint officials. We need to start today. Why not? Why not you? And why not now? Those are the questions you could ask yourself. Why not? In Nairobi, in Kenya, they have their challenges in education, but one thing they have no challenge over is mobilizing money and capital and supporting each other. I've come from a meeting and I'm going back there. We are talking about teachers, police people. What affordable housing can they have while in the service? On the day you get a job in the Ministry of Education, you sign up for an affordable house. How do you manage that as you go forward? A circle is going to be very important for that. A circle gives you a solid foundation for building what you have to build. Good people, I know that the time is gone, but I want to talk about how you grow. How you grow, you'll have to rely on other people. I want you to write the word angels in capital letters. Angels. This is how you grow. You need the angels around you. The first A is, as you work in the Ministry of Education, please think about one thing, that the world is changing. Now, the first A is asset capital. Don't create angels around you who have no asset capital. Asset capital does not mean assets, physical assets, but intellectual assets. It's asset. How many people do you know who have assets in terms of capital? Asset capital, intellectual. They have got sites where you can learn, that you can pick new information, new ideas. They have got sites which can improve you intellectually, even spiritually, morally. There are things you need to do and things you don't do. And good manners, good behavior. Right now, I don't know who is going to serve first or not. Most probably, my transport resource executives will be last. Well, maybe it doesn't have to be that. The big people should serve last. And that means the first ones who go there should have good manners, not to pick six pieces of chicken and so on. Good manners. So asset capital is more in terms of intellectual, spiritual, moral, and what we call social etiquette. Number two is in the word angels, there is N. N means network capital. Network, you need people who know others. You need three friends, but they are connected to six other people who can be useful to you. And for those of you who are preparing marriage, network is very important. You are a son of a local pastor, and you are marrying a daughter of the local butcher. That doesn't work. So you will need to expand. The other one is a taxi driver. And you're marrying a daughter of a nursery school teacher in Kasangombe, where you grew up. So all your friends are those you have studied with in Wobulesi, in Chambogo, and so on. Now, we have to move beyond. We have to move beyond where we were. And that it works well. It works well. My family, I'm very proud of it, and I always keep talking about this. 150 years ago, my great-grandfather was a cattle trader in Tanzania. My old aunties were married off in Tabora, others in Tanga, and some moved to Mazirui, and from Mazirui to Yemen and other places. There is no continent where my family is not. In Uganda, when I grew up, I found my sisters married all over, in Chigezi, in Ankole, in Busoga, and other places, even in Lango. Now, when my mom was about to die, we had some Thanksgiving function. She knew she was about to go. So they invited everybody around in the service. We had the big time Muslims in the corner. Some were half Arab, some were whatever, they were in the corner praying. Then there were fellows and people asking, is PK pure? Why? There were half Arabs, half Chinese, there were guys from Brazil and so on. They were all there. And people were saying, is PK pure? What do I need purity for? What do I need purity for? Among these ones are guys who are professors and they are below age 32, among this group you see. So what would we benefit if my grandfather made sure I'm marrying the next girl here, and I'm social? Now, network capital. Go beyond. You have talked about permanent and pensionable. No. Permanent and beyond pension. Let's go beyond. Let's go to number three, G. G is genius capital. Get close to people who have imaginative capacity, creative genius. They usually say talent is to achieve something no one else can achieve. That is talent. You achieve something no one else can achieve. Genius is the capacity to see what no one else is seeing. So you need guys who can see beyond and see more in you. Well, because right now you are what we call decision support executive, and somebody sees a minister in you. Those are coaches. That's genius. How many guys do you have who have got creative genius, who have imagination? And when you are in a crisis, they don't say, Bambi, ooh, ngachitalo. No. They just say that, let's go for plan A, plan B, plan C. That's a little better than commiseration. Let's go to E. E is experience, education, and exposure. How many people do you associate with who have got exposure? If you studied in Makerere, can you make friends of people who have been to Harvard and Princeton? If you are marrying a girl or marrying a husband, go for the one who studied where he did not. So you don't have a problem if you studied in Nyamitanga and you ended up in Nyendo. Okay, go for a girl from Oxford. That's all. But don't go for someone below now. Exposure. They are not wise king. They are exposed more than you are. So learn from them and associate with them. That is E. They have got better experience. Now let's go to L. In angels, the word L means light capital. Seeing light at the end of the tunnel. Have some optimistic people around you who can see light at the end of a dark tunnel. Right now, everybody's hurting. Money is not enough. There are all these problems. Someone sees light at the end of the tunnel. Not commiserating. That's light capital. And lastly is this, serene destiny. Serendestine is your coach, your mentor, your counselor. There are some of you right now who should already have divorced 10 years ago, but you are still there. I asked the husband, how is Margaret? Margaret is fine. I bought her a car. We have built a house. She's happy. I asked Margaret, how is your husband? How is the home? She says, if it were not for the children, I would have left already. So that is... So can we have someone who can shape your destiny and serene destiny at that? Good people, I don't want to stand between now and your lunch. I would like you to go home with the factor of three. I would like you, those who are Christians, even those who are not, go to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Remember your attitude, skills and knowledge, and your character. Remember, in any conversation, challenges, solutions, and impact. Remember to remain open-minded, curious, with a willingness to experiment on something new. Remember the 3 hours in your home. Create the 3 hours. Don't say you go home and tell your spouse, sit there. There's a man called PK, he said we have to spend 3 hours talking. No, just try to segment and fragment that time. Discussing what? Money. You people in Ministry of Education, change the way we have introduction ceremony, change the way we have weddings, change the way we celebrate graduation, change the way the festive mindset in Uganda works. Guys, I thank you very much for listening to me. You have my notes there with you.
Wow. Could we give him a standing ovation, please? I think that was too much learning for us. Thank you very much, Dr. PK. We can get seated, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much.